What if I could put him in front of you? The man that ruined your life. If I could guarantee that you'd get away with it, would you kill him?
They are the Queensland twins, done good. Peter and Michael Spierig are the directing duo behind Ethan Hawke's brand new time travel bender, Predestination. But it's a movie career that began in their backyard with zombies.
To a lot of aspiring filmmakers out there, you guys are kind of like the dream. You went from a very low budget film to suddenly you're making these huge genre pictures with Hollywood stars. What is the one piece of advice that you would say if there was a very green aspiring filmmaker sitting in front of you right now? Just, you know, let's role play. Let's imagine I'm 18 years old here.
I would say you have to go out and make films.
And action.
Michael and I never received any funding from anybody initially, so we just said, we're going to do it ourselves. We're going to put our life savings into it and we're going to make our own film.
Bugger me.
When you had made Undead, this cult hit movie, in my head, I imagine you rock up to LA and you're like, we've made this film, we made it for nothing, looks amazing, give us all your scripts. What's the reality?
It sounds like we made this film ages ago, but it was like 10 years ago that we made this film, and it was a different landscape for cinema. You know, like you could actually get a film like Undead into the theatres.
When I was a kid, we f***ing respected our parents. We didn't f***ing eat them.
The funny thing was, we went to the States, and their first comment was, do you think you can dub it into English?
Or at the very least, dub it into English that's not from central Queensland. You know?
It's warm. It tastes like camel piss.
And we had a screening in LA, and it was crazy. Tarantino turned up and Eli Roth, and it was just bizarre. It was this little movie that we'd made in my parents' backyard.
The crazies definitely come to this town for a visit.
Lionsgate asked us what we wanted to do next, and over lunch we pitched them our idea for a vampire movie.
Gentlemen, we are starving, and our latest statistics show that less than 5% of the human population remain.
What we're talking about is the extinction of the human race.
With Daybreakers, we were thinking, let's make a vampire film because nobody's doing them at the moment. And then when we release, of course, True Blood comes out, Twilight series starts. What's Twilight? I've never heard of Twilight. What is that?
You know, terrible. That's what that is. It's awful.
And our lead character, Ethan's character, was named
Edward
in Daybreakers. And then we saw a t-shirt in a window one day and it says, I heart Edward the Vampire. It's like, who knows about our film already?
Put some more f***ing blood in my coffee.
Three films, Undead, Daybreakers, and now this. Where was the moment you most felt like giving up in your entire career?
Last Tuesday.
Wow, jeez.
I mean, we've had a few very tough moments where you're very close to making a movie and then it falls over for some horrible reason. Those moments are tough.
Well, of course, famously, you two were both announced as the two that were going to give us a sequel to The Dark Crystal, which is one of those iconic 1980s movies. I have to ask, what happened?
Dark Crystal was, we're huge fans of the original, and to even go near it, we were terrified, but super excited.
What's it for? Is that what you want to know?
And it's very expensive. It would have been so much easier maybe if that was a CGI movie, but we wanted to do it as puppets.
Was that what it was? Did it come down to the fact that it was going to be a puppet? Or?
I think, yeah, people couldn't understand it, so unfortunately it didn't happen.
I've heard some incredible shit. Nothing astonishes me anymore.
But to the rest of that bottle, I got the best story you ever heard.
With this film you've got out now, you're dealing with areas of gender reassignment, time loops, a lot of kind of complicated issues.
I don't understand.
How hard is it to get people on board with, this should be a big movie?
Getting a film like that financed, you know, like, because it's such an out there subject matter, what we did is we sent it to Ethan.
The order finally came through today.
We figured Ethan likes this type of stuff and I think he's probably going to respond well to it.
I mean, come on. I mean, sometimes you got it.
He read it, he called us the next day, he said, I'm in. He said, just tell me which part I'm playing. And that's what it was. It was like, well, I'm not sure yet, but we'll figure it out. We'll figure it out.
You're not talking about bartending, are you?
I'm not talking about bartending.
And of course, anchoring the whole thing is Sarah Snook in this kind of amazing role.
Have you ever been with a man?
Have you?
How hard was it to find that one person who could do that.
It was very difficult. I mean, it because so much rested on her shoulders to go into the full man makeup and perform as the male character.
I always knew something was different about me.
We don't necessarily have a culture of making genre films in Australia.
We used to.
Why did that change?
See, we used to make genre pictures in the 80s, you know, people like Richard Franklin.
George Miller.
All those guys made genre pictures back in the day. Funding bodies didn't like genre pictures. You know, I guess people see it as like one step above porn or something like that. Whereas we grew up on genre pictures. I mean, we grew up in the days of the video nasties in the 80s. And genre pictures are very much about ideas. You know, it doesn't have to be about scale. It's all about ideas and concepts. And I'm so glad genre pictures are back. I think we're going to see more and more coming out of Australia.